Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to North Shore Live Cooper's Corner. We're live this evening. It is October the 7th, 2015, and we are fast approaching holidays of the fall of the year. I hope the weather has been kindly to you, some days rainy, some days not, but cool, and we certainly would like to make sure that we get the best of the last minute of summer in as much as we can. This evening's program should be one to really perk your adventure side of your life. And we have on our program this evening investigative journalist Michael Volpe. And his writing, again, is outstanding. He's going to tell us about a book that he's written. It's called Bullied to Death, and really outstanding. I'm going to hold this up. It's good reading, and it's thick reading. Look how thick that is. There it is. But you'll understand it when you read it. And this is a incredible. I think maybe I would just like to read a small portion from the back. So hang in there. This is Chris Mackney's Kafkaesque divorce. Six children, two fathers, a contract killing, a suicide, and a copyright notice for a suicide note. One person in the middle of all of it. That's the story in 30 words or less. It starts with a father of four getting shot in the head near the border in Texas in July 1968 and culminates with the murderer's son-in-law, a father of two, taking his life in Washington, D.C. in December 2013. This is all very, very close. This disturbing true story is one of millions which play out every day in family courts in the USA and over the world. Those who made this book possible sincerely hope that this exposure will be a small step to stopping the injustice. Published in conjunction with FamilyCourt.com, Inc., and edited by Michelle McDonald, practicing family law attorney, head of FamilyCourt.com, Inc., and former candidate for Minnesota Supreme Court. After spending more than a decade in finance, Michael Volpe has worked as a freelance investigative journalist since 2009. He's based in Chicago and has worked with Chicago area publication as a Chicago Reader, Chicago Crusader, Patch, and the Northwest Indiana Times National. He works with the Daily Caller, a big government front page magazine, WND, the Capital Research Center, and Counterpunch. Since 2010, Volpe has been recognized among whistleblowers as the leader in advancing their cause. His investigating, including corruption in the Veterans Administration, mortgage fraud, child abuse cover-up, child protective services corruption, civil rights abusers, whistleblowers, retaliation, guardianship abuse, and prosecutorial misconduct. His first book, Prosecutors Gone Wild, the inside story of the trial of Chuck Panici, John
Gliottoni,
sorry about this, and Louise Marshall, was published in October 2012. His second book, The Definitive Dossier of PTSD in Whistleblowers, was published in February 2013. So, welcome to the program.
Thank you for having me.
Ooh, nice warm hands. It's kind of chilly down here, but this is enthralling, adventurous, terrifying, scary. Oh,
very disturbing
everything
story.
You can imagine.
Right.
You tell exactly what went
on. Right. So the story, I guess, ends on December 29, 2013. Chris Mackney went to East Potomac Park in Washington, D.C., put a rifle underneath his chin in his parked car, and blew his head off. And that was the culmination of a divorce which lasted nearly 6 years. And he was bullied to death, as the title of the book suggests, and that's actually from a suicide note. The legal bullying started in earnest shortly after the divorce started, shortly after he discovered a dark family secret in his in-laws. So the dark family secret go back to July of 1968. A man named Pete Scamardo, which would be his future father-in-law, he was running low on cash. So he decided to do a heroin deal. And that heroin deal blew up in his face. The man that he hired for the heroin deal is a guy named Charles Harrelson. The last name sounds familiar. That's because he's the father, the father of the future actor Woody Harrelson. After the heroin deal blew up, he decided to hire Harrelson for his specialty. Charles Harrelson, some people know, some people don't, was a contract killer. Suspected in 20 murders, convicted in two, and one time he even suggested he had murdered JFK. So he hired Harrelson to kill his friend and business partner, a man named Sam DeGelia Jr. And the reason he did that is, as business partners, they had a life insurance policy on each other. And that's what Harrelson did. On July 6, 1968, he drove him to a shack near the border of Mexico, put him in the shack, had the guy get down on his knees, and put two bullets in the back of his head. The murder was Keystone Cops from the beginning, and everything was found out. Everyone got arrested. However, for reasons that aren't clear, Scamardo, who had no money, who did this murder because he wanted to collect on the insurance money, was able to hire a man named Percy Foreman, who at one time defended James Earl Ray, the killer of Martin Luther King.
Wow.
Some socialites. He's on almost everybody's short list for the greatest litigator in terms of being able to argue in court. This guy was no cheap lawyer. So Scamardo was still convicted of accomplice to commit murder, even though really this is conspiracy to commit murder. But somehow, Foreman convinced the jury to give him 7 years probation. So for killing his friend and business partner, the only jail time he ever did was about 4 days when he was first arrested before he got bail. So Scamardo moves he was living in a town in central Texas called Hearne. He couldn't go back there because his friend, the family, the friends were all there, and whether he was convicted or not, they all considered a murder. Moved out to Virginia, became a real estate magnate, and then about 30 years later, his daughter Dina met Chris Mackney. They get married in 2000. The divorce, or the marriage, is quite tumultuous. They have two kids, one in 2002, one in 2004. They start to get divorced. Now, as they start to get divorced, Chris, while he met her, while they dated, while they were married, doesn't know that his father-in-law is a murderer. They don't tell him this. So even before he finds out, as the divorce unfolds, they're still living together. So basically what happens with the divorce, the murder is very unique. Divorce is actually very common as far as abusive divorces. So they're living together, and his ex-wife, his still wife at the time, Dina, doesn't want him living with her. And the reason is possession is 9/10 in the law. What she wanted to do was possess the house, possess the kids, because that way, if she's possessing them as the divorce unfolds, she'll possess them when the divorce ends. So she did what I refer to as the silver bullet technique, which is very common. Not very common, but it's common enough, and a very vicious technique used mostly by women, not always. And in the book, I describe another technique that abusive men use, which is the opposite end of the coin. So I don't want anyone to think that women use stuff in divorce and men don't. There's techniques for both men and women. However, in this divorce, it was the abuser was a woman. So the silver bullet technique, what that is either just flat out false or very dubious allegations of abuse in order to get a restraining order. Because once you get a restraining order, the other person has to stay at least 500 feet away from you. So in this case, she gets a restraining order. Now he has to leave the house because she has a restraining order. Now, what do I mean when I say dubious? Well, she says things like, we had a fight, and Chris owns a gun, and I'm really scared, and he has a gun, and I'm really scared. And that's enough to get the restraining order. So these restraining orders are very easy to get. She uses these dubious allegations. She gets a restraining order. Chris is out of the house. Now, within 2 weeks of him being out of the house, he finds out about the murder. The day after he confronts her about the murder, she switches lawyers. Now, she had a law firm called Ain & Bank, which is generally considered one of the top law firms in the area. She switches to a firm which is run by a guy named Jim Cottrell. He advertises, this is what he advertises, he's not the type to settle, so have your wallets out. So that's the kind of guy she hired.
Wow.
So the next step in Chris's process is, her dad is worth $100 million, Chris has like $100,000,
wow.
So I need to bleed him dry of money. So what does Cottrell do? Anything he can think of, subpoena, deposition, conference, email, anything which will create not only billable hours for himself, but more importantly for the other side. And this is his MO. I show an example in another case. This is what Cottrell does.
Wow.
He confronts, and he creates a confrontational divorce. So within like 9 months of having a new lawyer, a guy named Robert Servell, Chris Mackney runs out of money. So this is now we're into like 2009, and Chris dies at the end of 2013. For the next about 4.5 years, except for a few months, he represents himself. And Chris Mackney representing himself against Jim Cottrell is sort of like the New England Patriots against an average high school team.
Oh, God.
So now, they've gotten him out of the house, he has no money, the next step is reduce and eliminate access to his kids. At this point, enter a man named Dr. Stanton Samino. That name sounds familiar. You're a fan of the TV show The Sopranos. His research was referenced in the second to last episode. It's called The Blue Comet of The Sopranos. In fact, his research is basically the centerpiece of the episode. But that reference was completely undeserved. This guy is total scum, and all he does is he lends his services to the highest bidder. In this case, it happened to be the Scamardo family. So he was brought in to do what's called a psychological evaluation. He wound up doing what's called a custody evaluation. I explained the difference. All people need to know is there's a difference. He was supposed to do one, he decided to do another, and it's because family court is so corrupt that they just allowed him on his own to do what he wanted. This custody evaluation was a hatchet job. Blamed Chris for everything, downplayed the murder. In fact, he didn't even call it the murder.
This is all true.
Right, it's all true. He didn't even call it a murder. He said the felony from the 60s. The felony from the 1960s, like it was a shoplifting beef that the dad was convicted of, not a murder of his friends.
The murder.
And then he said, and Mackney is obsessed with what he believes happened in the 1960s. But the most egregious thing he did, and I have a whole chapter. I won't give every detail. You can read the chapter. He claimed Chris Mackney had no friends, even though not only did he interview two of his friends, a guy named Mike Harris, a guy named Rich Ware. These were his friends since he was in college. He'd known these guys more than half his life, and he has the audacity to say he has no friends even after interviewing these two guys. And by the way, Mike Harris, Rich Ware, they live within like 15 minutes away from him. So they weren't just his friends. They weren't just his long-term friends. They were in the area.
Yeah.
And he also was supposed to interview two of his other friends, and he just didn't interview them. So using this hatchet job, initially his parenting time was down to 5% of the time. So he basically saw his kids almost never. And within a few months, and I describe it how it happens, because he didn't fax in a receipt, they just removed his parenting, his custodial rights entirely. So for not faxing in a receipt, they said, you know what, forget it, you can't see your kids at all. And starting March of 2010, until the day he died, he never saw his children again. Because he didn't fax in a receipt. So now...
A receipt? What was the receipt for?
He had switched apartments, and they basically proved that you had switched apartments.
Oh.
And he faxed in a lease, which was proof he had switched apartments.
But this is all trivial. This is
right,
nothing.
Very trivial.
What does that have to do with seeing your children?
It has nothing to do with seeing your children. That's how family court works. They want to get you. Anything you do wrong, we're going to get you. Don't fax in a receipt, boom, that's enough. Absolutely nothing to do with the kids.
Nothing to do with the kids.
So now, they've removed him from his home. They've taken away all of his money. They've removed access to his children. If you're trying to get someone to kill themselves, the only thing left is to take away your freedom.
Oh.
So over the last about 4 years of his life, he went to jail on 4 occasions, all at the behest of his ex-wife, probably mostly her dad. three times for civil charges, one time for criminal. Now, it gets technical, the civil charges, so I'm just going to give the most egregious one. So he put on Charles Harrelson's Wikipedia page, because as the father of Woody Harrelson, he has his own Wikipedia page, a reference to Pete Scamardo. He was not allowed to, this is in quotation marks, repeat allegations about Pete Scamardo. Now, that's a completely illegal order, and I should mention the judge is Randy Bellows. This is the man who decided that Chris Mackney has no free speech. Can't repeat allegations, completely disallowed, but it doesn't matter. This is what he did. Now, what did Chris Mackney put on the Wikipedia page? Pete Scamardo was also convicted in the murder of Sam DeJalia, and he got 7 years probation. That's not actually an allegation. That's what happened. Didn't matter. In a hearing that probably lasted less than 5 minutes, they threw him in jail for 10 days. Now, that's one jailing. He went to jail eventually for 6 months for being behind on child support, which is technically debtor's prison. But it wasn't even child support. It was bills related to the divorce.
And this is because the wife did this? The wife.
Absolutely. All that you put in civil contempt of court order, and you argue it, and you argue that he should go to jail, and boom, if the judge doesn't like you, he'll put you in jail. Remember, three times, including once for the violation of his free speech. He's in jail late 2012 to the middle of 2013. And here's the best part. They put him in jail to what they call compel him to pay, as if, like, if you're in jail,
how can you do that?
But at the same time, they put him in jail to compel him to pay. They rule him so indigent that they give him a lawyer. So on the one hand, they're saying you should pay, we're going to compel you. On the other hand, you're so poor, we're going to give you a lawyer. His lawyer argued that your arm's up. Yeah. He made the legal equivalent of what you have. He eventually got out of jail, but while he was in jail, he passed along a message from the other side. They said, they'll leave you alone if you promise to leave the state, never contact your wife, never contact your kids. Now, that's a pretty harsh thing to do, but given the abuse he took, leaves the state. Goes to Dallas, Texas, gets a job, starts, and he said, I started working out. Within a month, child support enforcement from Virginia starts to contact him about the past due child support. Now keep in mind, he's been in jail for 6 months, and I should mention, from almost the beginning, he had child support of $28.16 a month. This is for a woman who spent over $1 million paying for lawyers, claiming she needs $28.16 a month for child support. Somehow she has the $1 million for the lawyers, but she needs $28.16 a month. Now, he's making like $60,000 a year. You can do the math. $28.16 a month after taxes, he doesn't have it. So he first asks nicely if they'll reduce the child support. And when that doesn't work, he threatens to go to the media and talk about the abuse if they don't reduce the child support.
Sure.
So they go to the prosecutor's office in their county with this email. The prosecutor has him charged with attempted extortion, but it gets worse.
It's not extortion.
They send in the Dallas SWAT team, that's Special Weapons and Tactics, that's what SWAT stands for what's called attempted extortion. So there he is in his boxer shorts, and members of the SWAT team come in with their guns. So he's arrested, and then he's flown on Con Air. You remember the movie?
The real Con Air,
right? Now he's in a Virginia jail. He's languishing in jail. He begs to plead to a lesser charge. They go, no. Languish him in jail. He gets two public defenders because he has no money, and the two public defenders who'd never actually tried a case, they'd settled. They never tried a case in court, I should say. They had cases, but they always settled.
Settled.
Right. So they're pretty inexperienced. If you're a brand new lawyer, go to the public defender's office. This is the kind of lawyers he had. They argue that since child support is for the child, he couldn't be extorting any money from you, because it's supposed to go to the child, right? So the prosecutor, during her closing argument, said, use your common sense, the jury did, found him not guilty. That's October of 2013. Now, the same people who told him in 2012, leave the state, we'll leave you alone, they go, now, you need to deal with the divorce, stay in the state. Huh? So now it's October of 2013, and he realized that they're just going to screw with me till the end of my life, they're never going to leave me alone. He lost his will to live, and he killed himself. And he started, I should mention, the reason I wrote this book is he started talking to me towards the end of his life, and I didn't really help him, and so I felt a duty to tell his story. But his story doesn't even end with his suicide. So 2 days after his ex-wife sends a group email where she announces that he committed suicide. She claimed that he had a mental illness, which she claimed throughout. And that's there's a term for it called gaslighting, which is where you drive somebody crazy and then you call them crazy. It's from the very famous movie with Ingrid Bergman.
That's right, and Charles Boyer.
He's the gaslighter, right. He's the gaslighter, and he was gaslighting her. And there's a really famous line where he's like, I wish I could get inside your head to figure out where these thoughts are coming from. And he's putting the thoughts in her head, and she was doing the same thing. So that's the first step. The next thing I should mention, he left his laptop, which had all of the documents, some of them are in the book, related to the divorce. She tries to get the laptop from the Washington, D.C. Police Department, but the problem is he left a note and said, give it to my brother. Problem was his brother lives in California, so his brother had Mike Harris get him, but there's paperwork that needs to be signed if Mike Harris is going to act as his agent. So while that's going on, she goes to probate court and has herself named the executor of his estate. And I should mention, he didn't write a will, which was definitely a mistake, though he wasn't in the frame of mind to understand that. The acrimonious divorcee in a bitter divorce is made the executor of his estate. I should mention the judge is Judge James Allman, has a lot to answer for. So she gets herself named the executor of his estate, grabs the laptop, and then as executor of his estate, has Allman give her a copyright notice on everything he ever put on the internet, and starts, and what happened was, he had a blog called Good Men Did Nothing, it came down. In the blog was his suicide note. His suicide note then popped up on websites. So using the copyright notice, she started sending out threatening notes to these websites. You better take it down or we're gonna sue you.
Oh my goodness.
So there was a website, a men's right website, and they didn't even put up the note. They had a forum, you know, where people can argue and put, you know, people who have too much free time on their hands put stuff up. Right. So somebody put the note on their forum, and she's like, take it down immediately. And they give her the middle finger. They put the takedown notice, it's called the takedown notice, on their website. They repost his suicide note. When people read that, it went viral. And it's now on like 300 websites. It's in the back of my book. No one believes that her suicide note is legitimate. And the story basically ends with him becoming a martyr. And it's, and these are everyone, and right at the end of the book, I refer to all of them. These are all evil people in a cold-blooded way, in a horribly cold-blooded way. I mean, the father decided, because he was a little low on cash, that his good friend, a man he'd known since second grade, his business partner, no longer had the right to live because he needed his own cash. You know, that's the kind of evil you're dealing with. They were so evil, and they couldn't control their evil, basically, that they thought they could get away with copywriting the suicide note, and all of the information they tried to suppress is now just blown
all
up.
All over.
Right, and so that's basically the story in a nutshell.
What happened with her? What happened with the ex-wife?
Well, the ex-wife lives in the house they once owned with all of their possessions with the two kids. And
how old are the children now?
The one was born in 2002, the other one was born in 2004. And she has a jewelry business, and Oprah Winfrey wears her jewelry, Nora O'Donnell wears her jewelry. There's a lot of celebrities who wear her jewelry. If you see red on the jewelry, that's her ex-husband's blood that you're contributing to. She's a sort of successful jewelry designer. People are finding out about the story now. Initially, after the suicide note went viral, she was on the receiving end of just vicious internet stuff. Like, people were sending pizzas to her house, all kinds of stuff. That's died down. She still runs her business. She had a boyfriend who broke up with her. I imagine she'll never have a boyfriend for the rest of her life, because there's no way you want to date that woman. But she still has her business. Her dad is very successful, but he's near retirement age. But you know, this whole thing was done to suppress a murder, so I felt a duty to tell the details of the murder.
He wasn't too terribly old.
He's in his 70s now. He was born in 39.
Her husband.
Chris Mackney was born in 68. He was 45 years old.
Oh my.
Yeah, he died at 45.
This is incredible. Is there a possibility that maybe Hollywood could look at this as a
potentially, we'll see if somebody wants to, you know, it's a thought, but there's no one's offered me a big check.
Well, first of all, you've got someone of some notoriety here.
Right. It's Woody. We need to change everybody's name, though.
Yeah, but it's Woody Harrelson's
right,
dad.
Right, but you have to change everybody's name.
Well, to protect those. Okay, that's understandable.
Because I don't think Woody Harrelson would allow me to use his name.
No, no, but this is life. This is true. This is a true story.
The more important thing, not just the specifics, like the silver bullet technique, very common. Very common. Suppressing free speech in family court, very common. I have a whole section I call No Free Speech in Family Court. I have a great example. A guy named Ronald Pierce was out in California, got screwed in his divorce, was invited to speak at a rally for like a father's rights group. So he speaks at the rally. The guy who put on the rally videotapes it, puts it on YouTube. His ex-wife's lawyers find out about it. They claim that by him speaking, that he was harassing her. Now, it's on YouTube. I looked it up right now. Less than 300 people have viewed his speech, so that must have been some serious harassment. So they use that to extend a restraining order, gag orders, these other flimsy orders. You're not allowed to say this, you're not allowed to say that, you're not allowed to repeat allegations. There's basically no free speech in family court that's not specific to Chris Mackney. This strategy of inundating people with legal work so that they run out of money.
True.
Very common.
True, yes.
Custody evaluators, psychologists, they're very common, and they're almost all just as corrupt. This guy Samenow. In fact, in the book, I describe three other cases with Samenow, but there are a plethora, if you will, of court professionals who all they really do is corrupt the court.
They suck the money out of the victims.
Correct. You know, and you've done a lot with guardianship.
Yes.
There are different names. They do
the same thing.
Right. There's no difference.
That's right.
Except for the names. Right. They're brought in ostensibly to fix things. In reality,
they're supposed to be officers of the court.
Right.
Uphold the Constitution. So give you free speech.
Here's the problem. They have an inherent conflict of interest. So basically, in order for them to make money, the conflict needs to go on for as long as possible because that justifies them being in.
The reason why they're there. Yeah.
If they're like, this is the problem, and if you get them out and you leave everything here, then it's fine. I describe one of the worst cases that I'm familiar with out of Connecticut, a woman named Sunny Kelly. So she was married to a physical and emotional abuser. As their divorce unfolded, she figured out he was also a sexual abuser. So she took her son when she found out, and her son basically described it in detail. My dad has me play the tickle the weenie game. All right, he describes it in detail. She once said her son's butt was shredded. Oh. I mean, you can just imagine what that was like. So she takes it to CPS or whatever they call it out in Connecticut. She takes it to the cops. They bury it. The divorce brings in, I think, 12 court professionals to do a bunch of evaluations, and they all decide, and these people are not experts in anything, they all decide she's the problem, and she spent over $1 million, and her kid is being raised in sole custody by the sexual molester, her ex-husband, because they decided she was making it up, even though all she was doing was repeating the allegations her son was making, and she would bring in She brought in a guy named Dr. Eli Neuberger, who runs I don't remember what it's called, but he runs at Boston Children's Hospital, he runs the section of the hospital for kids who are sexually molested. Like, that's an expert. And he described the scene where in the middle of the doctor's room, when the dad walks in, he runs over, sits down, and starts massaging his son's legs. And he's like, that's how obsessive as a sexual molester he was. That even though all the doctors are watching, he couldn't contain himself. He had to massage the guy's leg, and they just dismissed him. They said, oh, he's a hired gun. We have people over here. And it was like a slew, parenting coordinator, guardian ad litem, which is in guardianship, a bunch of them, over 10. She spent over $1 million trying to keep her kid away from the molester, and the whole thing was designed to give the kid to the molester. So, the things that happened to Chris Mackney, it's jailing you on these specious charges. I described a case, Janice Walk Grenadier, who was in like 20 minutes away from Chris Mackney. They decided that she owed money to not her attorney, the other attorney. So she comes in for a contempt of court hearing, and they're like, you owe her $7,000. And she's like, Your Honor, I have no money. And they're like, well, no, you live in a $700,000 house. And she goes, but I'm past due and I have no money. And they go, we don't care, we're going to put you in jail. And this is, keep in mind, we don't have debtor's prison. You're not allowed to put people in jail because they owe money. That's not supposed to happen anymore. All right? So she goes to jail for 22 days. They put her in solitary confinement for 14 days. The hearing lasted like 10 minutes. 10 minutes, they decided because she owed the opposite attorney that we're going to go ahead and put you in jail. When they realized that putting her in jail wasn't gonna get her the money,
that's right.
The judge said, you win, and he looks at the other attorney, you're gonna have to file a judgment, which, by the way, is what you're supposed to do if you're owed money. You file a judgment. That's what happens. So the things that happened to Chris Mackney, all of it, removing him from the house, the silver bullet technique, I describe it in detail. I have two other specific examples. I have stats. I have just all of these quotes. There's a guy named Neil Shelton out of Mount Airy, North Carolina. What's interesting is Mount Airy is where Andy Griffith is from. It's actually the town that was the basis of Mayberry. His ex-wife, the exact same thing. She's like, well, he's never hit me before, but now that we're getting divorced, he knows I'm serious, and so I need protection. That's what she said. And that removes him from the house. Now he's deemed an abuser, so they do, it's called an ex parte hearing. What that means is he wasn't there. His lawyer wasn't there. And they say, he's very dangerous. You need to keep him away from the kids. Boom, keeps him away from the kids. And then they just keep refiling. And once you're deemed an abuser.
But ex parte, that's not allowed. You have to have both sides.
You have to have.
Both sides.
No, if I'm running around with an axe, it's allowed. But
an axe.
In extraordinary cases, you can. There's another great example of an ex parte hearing. So, and they use that to keep him away from the kids, and they still keep him away from the kids. And he told me, the book was published, so this isn't in the book. He just had a hearing, and the divorce is so incredibly screwed up. They brought in a judge from another county, and the judge looks at it and goes, they should have never given you a restraining order. And he goes, great, Your Honor. So the entire reason that I'm kept away from the kids is because of this restraining order, which you've just said is bogus. So I should start seeing my kids. And he goes, this temporary order was signed 3 years ago, and if a temporary order is kept in place for 2 years, it becomes a permanent order. So, but he goes, but it's based on a bogus restraining. He goes, I don't care. So,
he kept it.
So even though the judge said you're not supposed to have a restraining order, I mean, that's how this works. Complete lack of due process. There's another story I tell in the book. A guy named Surrender Malhan. His ex-wife walks into her judge's chamber ex parte and goes, my husband's a horrible person. You need to keep him away from my kids. Judge goes, sure. Signs the order. This happens in New Jersey, in Bergen County. There's a local newspaper where there's a guy named Paul Nichols who's done a really good job on a lot of these stories. Paul Nichols wants to interview Surrender Malhan. The judge goes, oh, no. It's not in the best interest of the children for you to talk to the press.
Oh, my goodness.
So the judge who issues the bogus order issues another bogus order to keep the press from finding out about the first bogus order. Now, fortunately, in this case, the Bergen Dispatch filed in federal court saying that this bogus gag order violates our First Amendment right, and the judge agreed. So the judge who did all of this was exposed, and eventually Malhan was able to see his kids. But you're right, sir, ex parte, you're not supposed to do it.
Not supposed to do it.
And yet in family court, you're going to find a plethora of examples.
Well, what happens to these judges? How can we, the public, get rid of these judges, get them
very
off the
hard,
bench.
Very hard. So the problem is that outside courts rarely want to get involved because, for the most part, they see this as judgments of the judges. So
bad.
What you need to have is an egregious violation of the Constitution. Now, and this also is not in the book, what I'm about to say. My editor is a woman named Michelle McDonald, and she's taken pro bono the most notorious custody case in Minnesota, at least currently, probably in the history of Minnesota. It's the Grazini-Ruckey case. So David Ruckey is an abuser. You know, some people will be afraid to say that. He's an abuser. So he abused his ex-wife. He abused their kids. So this the judge in the custody case, a guy named David Knutson, who once sentenced a child molester to like 60 days in jail, had himself put on the case, even though you're supposed to be put on randomly, and told Sandra Grazzini Rucki to vacate the house in a few hours, and I disallow you from talking to anyone you know. Does that sound right?
No.
You'd think that doesn't sound right. Yeah, and then he took away custody from her, handed it to her ex-husband without a hearing, also not allowed. And then eventually figured out the ex-husband's not supposed to have custody, so he gave it to his sister. The kids, since the middle of 2013, are in the wind. No one knows where they are because they had had enough of Knutson's nonsense. They didn't want to be raised the way they were raised. So she's actually challenging this to the Supreme Court, which could be a landmark case if the Supreme Court even takes it. And it's 1 in 1,000 that it would be taken. But if the Supreme Court takes it, that's an example of where these judges will be held accountable. It's very difficult. I don't know if I describe it in the book. There's a guy named Ulf Carlson, who was one of the featured people in the documentary Divorce Court, which is one of the most well-known divorce-related media subjects. So Carlson's divorce, very similar to Chris Mackney. His ex-wife got everything. Everything went against him. Never sees his daughter. So he challenged all that to the appeals court, and they said, you know, that sounds bad, but that's a judgment by the judge. The one thing he was able to get was he was making his case, and the judge just left.
What do you mean? He just picked up and walked out?
Yeah.
How do you do that in a courtroom?
These judges are so full of hubris that if they don't like you, they'll just leave the court. So the appeals court said, well, that's a violation of your due process. So they did rule on that, but they didn't rule on the fact that he got no assets, wasn't able to see his children, and basically was not given any fairness in the court. What they ruled on is the judge is supposed to sit in his chair and at least pretend like he's listening to you while you make your case. And since he didn't, that's a violation of your due process. But, you know, most of these rulings.
What about assaults from the judge on the defendant? If the judge makes comments about them, is that allowed?
Not only is it allowed, it happens. Now there's a very notorious case that's unfolding as we speak, the Simone case. So once again, an abuser, a man named Omer Simone, abuses his kids. So his kids want nothing to do with him. You know what the judge did? She sentenced the kids to juvenile hall until each turned 18. Now, fortunately, because they wouldn't see their dad. And she you know what she ordered? I order you to have a healthy relationship with your dad. Now, is that something you could order?
Does that sound
like social engineering?
What is that?
Right. So the case, fortunately, was covered nationally. So instead of sending them to juvenile hall, she sent them to this camp, where basically they try to reprogram you and convince you your dad's not a bad guy. Without an evidentiary hearing, without anything, the mother's not allowed to see the kids because she's deemed it parental alienation, which is a whole, I don't know, we don't have time to talk about parental alienation. My opinion is
we'll
junk
do
science.
Another show on
right,
it.
Right, right. It's total okay. junk science. So basically, she's going to try to convince the kids that he's really not an abuser. But she has throughout been vicious towards the mother, towards the children, at one time she said, if this hearing moves forward, I'm going to send you to jail and I'm going to have your strip searched. Completely allowed. Just allowed to go on. These judges will berate litigants.
Oh, litigants. Yeah.
These people aren't even criminals. They're getting a divorce. They're not even criminals. They're getting a divorce. Yeah. They're berated. They're demeaned. They're belittled. And it's allowed because these appeals courts have decided that it's all, this is part of their.
How about if you're called a mother dog?
No, that's allowed. Yeah, no, that stuff.
The judge can call you a mother dog?
What the judge can't do is leave the bench during the trial. But if they call you names, if they do that kind of stuff, that's okay. The appeals courts rarely get involved. Now, this Grazzini-Rucki case, maybe the Supreme Court. Now, what Michelle McDonald, the centerpiece of her argument is that by reporting himself on the case when it was supposed to be done randomly. He was making an administrative act, and he's not an administrator, and that violated her due process. Now, if that works, that's sort of a gimmick, though it really isn't, because he clearly won it on the case. And by the way, parental alienation, that's what Knudsen claimed.
Parental alienation.
That these kids weren't really being abused, that the mother was a parental alienator. And it happens all the time. Abusers scream parental alienation. Do you know who actually probably started this? Albert Einstein.
Why would that be?
Albert Einstein, as it turns out, was a domestic abuser. Now, he married a woman.
Do we know this for a fact?
Yes.
This is all factual.
Yes. He was arrested twice for domestic abuse. So he was married, had two kids with his wife. Marriage, I think, was her name. And then they broke up. Do you know why they broke up? Because he decided to shack up with his cousin. So he shacks up with his cousin. His ex-wife said, you know, you want to see your kids? That's cool. This is me paraphrasing.
All right.
But don't bring your cousin / lover around. Hopefully I don't have to explain why she thought that was a bad idea.
Oh.
And he's like, no, I'm going to bring my cousin / lover along. She's like, then I'm not going to let you see your kids. So he writes his friend, and he's like, she's alienating, she's poisoning their minds. She's alienating me from my children. No, she doesn't want you to be around with your cousin / lover. But like every other domestic abuser, Albert Einstein thought he was an alienated parent. You know what alienates you? Is when you beat up the mother of the child. That will alienate you real quick. So the Grazzini-Rucki case is an example of that. I describe several examples of that. And there's so many different concepts in court that these court professionals manipulate. And it's all, you're right, some of it is ideological. This Judge Gorsica, she's a parental alienation ideologue. All you need to do is go into her court and scream parental alienation, and she believes you.
What about the backgrounds from some of these judges? Some of these judges have real mental disabilities.
Right.
They themselves don't really belong on the bench.
This is not in the book, but they
take out their hostilities on innocent people.
This is not in the book, but generally, if you're a divorce court judge, it's because they don't want you in a more prominent court. It's because, you know, they don't want you trying the murder case because you're going to do something stupid in the murder case and everybody will know. We're going to pack you in the divorce where nobody sees you.
Yeah.
And then this leads me to another point. So if you're hearing this and you're going, why don't I see this in the media? This sounds very interesting.
Yeah, why is it in the newspapers or something?
You're right. Why isn't it in the newspapers?
Okay.
Half the marriages end in divorce, right? That seems to be an important issue. Well, here's what happens. The media has decided this is he said, she said. So they don't want to take it on because, well, it's just
one side, the other side.
Okay. Right. This is what they've decided. Now I'm gonna blow that out of the water. They've decided unless it's a celebrity, like Kelly Rutherford, the actress, is involved in a bitter divorce. So that's not private matter. She's a celebrity. The other thing, this is a third thing. This is ripe for defamation and libel suits. You make these charges. If you get anything wrong, you're set up for defamation and libel. But here's the key. Here's the key. We live in a liberal versus conservative media. Now, whether you're liberal, conservative, or you even believe you're objective, I don't believe there's actually anybody who's objective. You cover stories which are important to either liberals or conservatives. So divorce. So you think about this, custody and divorce. Is there like a liberal angle on custody and divorce?
I don't know. I've never thought of that.
There isn't. Is there a liberal, is there a conservative angle? No. So conservatives don't care, liberals don't care, so the media in the mainstream doesn't care. Whether you're liberal, conservative, or in the middle. So the examples I had, there's a, I can't remember the guy's last name. I
never even thought of that.
Right, so here's a story that happened. So it was a guy, he was a Navy guy. I think his name is Pounds. And I think he's from Ohio. So the judge tells him to be in court one day. And if you're not in court, I'm going to take away custody of your daughter. And he said, Your Honor, that's a problem, because I'm supposed to serve on a ship that day. I'm serving my country that day.
Okay.
The judge said, I don't care. So the minute the conservative media found out about that, they ran wild with it. It was on Drudge Report. It was on Fox News. This congressman from Ohio said, family courts need to respect our military people. So why was that covered and nothing else? Because conservatives love the military and they love to show any story of people mistreating the military. So there was another story, and it was done by a woman named Raquel Oquier, where two men had their Second Amendment rights taken away as part of bitter divorces. She put that in town hall. Why? Because town hall loves to do Second Amendment stories. They love to show stories where your Second Amendment is being squelched, and here's a divorce squelching the Second Amendment. Problem for Chris Mackney is there is no clear conservative versus liberal angle. And I did a hypothetical. Let me give you a hypothetical. Let's imagine there is no murder. Let's imagine this, that Pete Scamardo, he's a real estate mogul. And the way he became a mogul is he hired a bunch of illegal aliens, and he paid them less than a minimum wage, and then he funded the like La Raza and those kinds of groups to keep the flow of illegals coming. Okay. And then Chris Mackney found that out, and the rest of the story is the same. Now, do you think I could go to the conservative media with that story? They love that story. They'll love. You know why? Now you got illegal immigration in it. Now let me give you another story. Imagine there's no murder, but what Scamardo was doing was dumping waste into the ocean and then polluting the ocean because he didn't want to clean it up properly. And then he funded groups which challenged the environmentalists, so they'd be called wackos when they challenged him. Right. Now, you think I could take that to like a Mother Jones or a Huffington Post? No, they love stories where people pollute the ocean. So think about what that means. Hiring a bunch of illegals and polluting the ocean to the media is more important than murder. Now, let me just blow out of the water, he said, she said. Bet you didn't know this, but President Obama wouldn't have been president if there weren't two nasty divorces. Bet you didn't know that. You want me to prove it?
If you've got the stage, go ahead.
So when he was running for the U.S. Senate in the Democratic primary, he wasn't going to win. The leader was a guy named Blair Hull. And the media went to multiple judges until one of them unsealed the divorce.
They went judge shopping.
Right. And in the divorce, his ex-wife accused him of being violent towards her, which actually sounds like silver bullet technique. And probably may have, I won't say probably, may have been, it may have been that someone executing the silver bullet technique created President Obama.
Here in Illinois.
Right, yeah. So Blair Hull was leading, then splashed all over the newspaper. In divorce, he's accused of being a violent man. So for 3 days, now keep in mind, they had no idea if that was true. It was an accusation made in a divorce. You know how many accusations are made in a divorce? Oh, but no problem. We'll print it like it's fact. Blair Hull gets out of the race. President Obama, then State Senator Obama was like fourth and fifth, jumps to first, wins the Democratic nomination. Jack Ryan won the Republican nomination. He was married to the actress Jerry Ryan. The media again goes judge shopping. They unseal his custody, not even his divorce, even though both Jack Ryan and Jerry Ryan, I won't even mention the accusation, but basically Jerry Ryan accused him of not being a sexual deviant, but of asking her to be involved in like a weird sexual escapade while they were vacationing in Europe. All right? Not even all the time. One time. And here's the best part. When she said no, he said, fine, let's leave. So anyway,
oh my goodness.
This comes out. The media blinks at it for like 3 days. He has to drop out of the race. Now, did the media treat that like he said, she said? Because guess what? Blair Hull said he was never violent towards his ex-wife. Jack Ryan said the incident never happened.
Never happened, so.
But they didn't care.
Once it's out in print, I mean, how do you can't retract that. You can't retract that, though.
Why is the media, which considers divorce, he said, she said, printing an accusation from an ex-wife that you can't corroborate? Why are they doing that? Okay. I thought
they want to stir the pot. They want to stir the pot.
Well, apparently it's he said, she said, unless you're running for the U.S. Senate. And then whatever happens in your divorce is game. So it's he said, she said, unless you're the sort of person I want to go after. Now, what's interesting is Pete Scamardo has built quite the reputation with the Washington, D.C. area media. And that specifically is the Washington Post. If you've read the Washington Post over the last 3 decades, you think he's an upstanding citizen. You have no idea that he murdered someone. You have no idea that he drove his son-in-law to suicide. No idea. So he's a fine, upstanding citizen. They probably wouldn't want to challenge him. Dr. Stanton Samuel, oh my God, has he been written about it in the Washington Post, all over the place. He's a swell guy. So maybe they don't want to challenge those guys too much. And I should mention one other thing that I found out. This could mean nothing, but Stanton Samuel's son, Jason Samuel, just happens to be a weather editor at the Washington Post. And that's interesting because Chris Mackney begged the Washington Post to do his story. Now maybe it's all a coincidence and Jason Samuel.
I don't believe in coincidence, you know, I just don't.
Right, you're rule number 39 of Jeff,
I am not, I don't believe in coincidence.
You watch NCIS?
Yes, I do.
You and Leroy Jethro Gibbs, rule
yes,
number 30.
That's
rule
right,
number 39, there are no coincidences in investigations.
That's
now,
right.
The court reporter, his name is Tom Jackman, he denied that it has anything to do with anything. He's like, what have you proven? If we want to go after Samuel, the weather reporter, weather editor would have nothing to do with it. Well, the weather editor happens to be his son. So I'm not saying he had anything to do with it. What I do know is the story that you read in this book is the same story that Chris Mackney gave the Washington Post, but they didn't want any part of it. Even though I'm from Chicago and geographically have less of an interest in it than the Washington Post, even though a murder, the Sopranos, a real estate mogul, that sounds like a lot of cool stuff that you could put in the story, but I'm sure that Jason Samuel and Stan Samuel's son had nothing to do with it. The media, it's wrapped up in a lot of complicated issues. The other thing that I should mention, my favorite journalist is a woman named Cheryl Atkinson, and she recently wrote a book called Stonewalled. And there specifically, these stories are investigative journalism. There are specific problems in all investigative journalism that has nothing to do with family court. So you have all of these family court issues. You have investigative journalism issues on top of it. It's a toxic combination.
Yeah,
you'll rarely hear these stories in the mainstream, even though half of marriages end in divorce. Even though divorce is a $50 billion a year industry, and if you add up all the other courts and combine them, they don't add up to $50 billion a year. Even though we have these systemic problems, we have all of these issues. These are violations of your due process, of your constitutional rights, you know, free speech.
How do we fix this? There are stories galore, but
right,
how do we fix this? Do we bring people to come in and to sit to listen to what's going on in the court?
So there are several things. So first of all, you put cameras in the courtroom. Not first of all, that's one idea.
Yeah.
Put cameras in the courtroom. Make it more transparent. There's a lot of money. There's a lot of gender-based money, and I describe this in the book. So the easiest thing is you cut off all of the grants from both sides. So why do abusers scream parental alienation? The reason is there's a lot of fatherhood grants, which make it easier for them to scream it. So you get rid of that. Why is it so easy for the silver bullet technique? There's a lot of grant money that goes along with the silver bullet technique. So you get rid of both of it. You save billions, get rid of that money. Another idea that I had is jury trials for custody. See, you have these corrupt judges, these judges that are incompetent. Well, don't give them the decision.
Totally incompetent.
Right,
oh,
so make it a jury trial. So that's another idea.
There's jury tampering. Yeah,
well,
I mean, there's
right, look,
more.
There's no complete answer. But I'm more comfortable with 12 regular people deciding custody than I am with a judge.
Judgment.
The other thing is these custody values, guardian ad litem, get rid of all of them, make it all illegal.
Oh, absolutely.
So the problem, the problem theoretically with the, in a broad term with divorces is they're complicated. So what you need to do is you just streamline and simplify. Every answer towards fixing the problem in family court is streamline and simplify. If it does that, and so all these court professionals. In Sonny Kelly's cases, what do you need 10 court professionals for? All they did was complicate the issue.
The same problem.
So make it all illegal.
Well, let me just hold up the book, Bullied to Death. Here's the book.
So Bullied. If you go to Amazon, Barnes & Noble, Books A Million, or whatever is your favorite online bookstore, it's not available in regular bookstores yet, but
well,
if any of the online retailers,
we're really not supposed to talk about ordering books. Mm-hmm. All I'm talking about is the fact that this is a true story.
Right.
And
not just one true story. There's about 100 true stories.
Many true stories in here. This is a life and death situation.
Right.
And the fact that the court system is corrupt.
Right.
Right. And we're finding that in probate court for sure. Right. I know that
right.
to be a fact. Many others that I've connected with. Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot
juvenile
of
court out here, right. that's corrupt. We know that
all
to be
the courts,
a fact.
All the courts are corrupt. There are special problems, and probate court and family court are very, very similar. There are special problems in probate court and family court that are very, very similar that makes them especially corrupt. Look, the first thing people need to know is they need to know. So if you don't know that it's happening, then there won't be any fix.
You don't know.
The powerful people know. They want it suppressed.
Yeah.
So this is one step towards getting.
Well, we need to bring in court watchers. That will be good.
There are court watchers.
We used
now.
To be court watchers.
Right.
Well, I just want to tell our viewers that you can find this. This is going to be on YouTube. And you'll be able to hear and see Michael all over again on YouTube. This is going to be part one. We're going to do a part two sometime in December.
I'm doing two family court-related stories in the Chicagoland area. I'll come back, and I'll tell the stories and how they relate to Chris Mackney's story.
Okay.
And how all of this stuff comes together.
And if you have any questions, you can contact me. There's my email, bev.cooperscorner@yahoo.com. And if you have a story that you'd like to tell, you can contact me. Or Michael, if there's a story you'd like to tell him. It's a very thick book, as you can see. Look how thick that is. There it is.
Right. So I should mention that one of the reasons it's thick is it has a very thick appendix, because I make some very serious charges. Now, part of the appendix is Chris Mackney's blog, because... it's like a dagger for free speech. His ex-wife didn't want people to read his blog, so she threatened his family and they took it down. I believe that what he wrote, people should have the opportunity to read it. But it's not quite as long as you think, because a lot of it is the appendix and many people won't read that.
We need the public to know they have a constitutional right. And I know the problem that we had in probate court in Cook County, the judge...
Count.
Yeah, but the judge left the state. I mean, we must have been, we told the truth. We need to remove Miriam Solo because she doesn't tell the truth. But Judge Kawamoto did leave the state. So, you know, one judge down, two judges down. I think that there was another judge that went down. But it's not enough. We need to clear the bench, put people in that are honorable with integrity, and uphold the Constitution. Uphold the Constitution. We don't need long time term people in there that are in there for the money and the get. They
right.
just
it's
go.
Very easy to get money as
so,
a judge in both those areas.
We do come back. We're going to expect you sometime in November, December,
right.
And come back on the program. This is part one. We're going to have a part two. I'm enthralled with this book, Adventuresome and exciting and unfortunate suicide and the death.
It's very sad, but I think people need to know what happened.
Well,
because if you don't know, the next person will be here.
Yeah. God forbid. Well, we want to thank you for coming on the program.
Thank you for having me.
My pleasure. Oh, warm hands again. This is good. See you next week on North Shore Live, Cooper's Corner. Have a pleasant evening, a very safe week, and please go to the YouTube. It'll be marvelous. You'll be able to see everything. Thank you for watching. Have a pleasant evening.